Some things that are in the bulletin that are not going to be on the slides behind me. Today, the youth ministry is having a Super Bowl party. So if you are 6th or 12th grade, there's a Super Bowl party that will be in the big building just behind us in the Family Life Center. So you can join them for that. The details are in the bulletin. Also, we've got Father-Daughter Dance is coming up in March, and there's details on that in the bulletin as well. So make sure you check those things out. But also, on the side of the bulletin is our Connect card. We ask that you fill that out, leave it on your pew. If you are new with us and have never turned one of these in before, we would love to meet you, and you can meet us back at the Welcome Center after the service. We have a gift for you there as well. So if you are new with us, we would love to meet you at the Welcome Center. Otherwise, tear that off, leave it on your pew. There's going to be some things I talked about that you can sign up for, so that's the place to do that as well. Some other things that we have coming up this Friday is our Valentine's date night. So a great opportunity for couples to come have a free night out, and there's going to be music and dancing. Again, that's going to be in the Family Life Center, the big building right behind us, and babysitters are provided. There will be some food. It will be a great time, so I encourage you to sign up for that. There's a sign-up sheet out in the lobby for that. Also coming up is our 101 class, and 101 is kind of your first step in becoming a member. You'll find out who we are, what we believe in. And that's going to be a four-week class starting next Sunday during the 9:30 hour. And you can sign up for that on the Connect card. So if you've never gone through the 101 class, even if you've been here for a long time and never did 101, we really encourage you to. And I asked my friends, the Skid Guys, to make us a special little video to tell us more about why a membership class is important.
I want to make a quick announcement about our membership classes coming up.
I'm good. I've been coming to this church for a long time. I'm already a member.
Are you?
Yes, I am. Ask me anything about the church, and I will tell you anything you want to know.
Okay. Help me understand why we do what we do. Meaning, help me understand our mission statement, per se.
We go out there in the world to do good in the world, because too much is given. You know, much power comes great responsibility. That's the backbone of what we do. So then we do that on mission trips, so to speak.
You just quoted Spider-Man, and you have no idea what
I'm talking about. I do know. I think we should just pretend. I think everybody out there sitting there, you don't need to be a member, just pretend.
No. Listen, you can't pretend. You think you can pretend to be a part of a wonderful church body and just not participate in it or know why they do what they do?
You lost me.
Okay, let me try this way. Okay, if you lived in a garage, would that make you a car?
No one made me a car.
No one made me a car.
What about that car? Okay, I get your analogy, okay? Just stop it, okay? You're not my dad. Get off my back. But go to the class. You're not my dad.
Join us for membership classes.
Room, room.
Stop. You don't get to do that.
You got to be
it. I'm a member.
All right, so next one. You can't just pretend to be a member. We encourage you to join the 101 class. So sign up for that on your Connect card. Leave that on your pew, and we'll follow up with you on the details. But that starts next Sunday. Great thing to be a part of. Also, coming up, if you are a high school student, know a high school student, if you see a high school student, let them know about the lock-in coming up on Friday, February 17th. It's going to be a great time for all the high school folks to stay up all night. And there's going to be a lot of games, inflatables, food, some great stuff going on there. So make sure you get the word out about the high school lock-in coming up. Also today, if you don't have any lunch plans, private graduation from a high school is selling spaghetti lunches in the Family Life Center. It's $10 for chicken spaghetti, potato salad, bread pudding. So if you didn't have any lunch plans, if you didn't already buy a ticket for that, they should still have experts for that. Right, Kathy? Yes. She's nodding her head. All right, so after church, you can go get a lunch back there for $10. So again, reminder, fill out your Connect card. Leave that on the pew for us. And I would ask that you stand as I pray for our time this morning. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for the opportunity to come together, to worship you, to learn from your word, to be encouraged by time of fellowship with one another. And Father, I do pray that we would have just ears to hear what you want us to hear this morning, that we would be blessed by our time together, that you would be glorified through our prayers, through our praise, and through the preaching of your word. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Who's on his mind? this morning, as we prepare to celebrate the Lord's Supper, I'd like to ask the deacons and the ushers who are going to help distribute the elements to come on front. Come on up front. Now, this year's theme is...
Tell somebody.
Well, that's close. That's the study we're doing. But it's reach out. So I'm going to give you one more chance. This year's theme of 2017 is...
Reach out.
One more time. It's...
Reach out.
All right. That's what we're doing this year. We're really reaching out. And what are we reaching out with? We're reaching out with the gospel. Well, what's that? Well, the gospel really comes from two little Greek words put together that literally means good news. And the incredibly good news that God wants us to reach out and share with our world is just beautifully, beautifully pictured for us in the Lord's Supper that Jesus initiated 2,000 years ago. The two elements. First of all, we've got the bread. The bread which Jesus broke as they're eating the Passover Supper. And he explained that it represents his body, his broken body. Now, broken is not like just breaking your arm or breaking your leg. Broken means dead. It means his body was dead. It died on the cross. Well, why did he have to die? Because of your sins and because of my sins, which prevent us from being able to have a relationship with God. The Bible says all of us, like sheep, have gone astray. The Bible makes very clear that all of us fall way, 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 way short of even coming close to being good enough to get to heaven. And that's why Jesus came, to die for our sins, to pay for our sins so that you and I wouldn't have to. Romans 5:8, for God demonstrates his love for us in this. While we're still sinners, Christ died for us. That's the bread. Now, the cup represents the blood that Jesus shed on the cross as he was dying for us. Let's think about that blood for a minute. You know, remember that crown with those big old thorns that shoved down on his head? He had blood trickling down his face. His back was just ripped to shreds by a Roman flogging. That was bleeding a lot. Then those 9-inch spikes, they pounded through his hands, they pounded through his feet, nailing him to that cross. Let me tell you, there was a lot of blood flowing that day. And that's bad news for Jesus. Let me tell you, that's good news for us. That's good news for us because in doing that, you know, he died for us, and that blood is a beautiful picture how it just washes away all of our sins. And for those who believe in Jesus, those who trust that his death really did pay for their sins, those who accept him into their life as their Lord and Savior, let me tell you, we got some really good news. And here's the good news. Because of what Jesus did, we get to enter into the family of God. Our sins are once and for all forgiven. We are able to initiate and begin a personal love relationship with Jesus Christ that starts now and goes to the end of your life and then all through eternity. Let me tell you guys, that is some good news, and that is good news very worth sharing with other people. So, as the worship team sings, I want you to prepare your hearts, our hearts, to receive communion by doing two things. Now, as you're sitting there preparing to come up, or as you grab the cup and go back to receive it, do two things. One, just thank Jesus. Thank you for him being willing to pay that price to free you from your sin. Just thank him from the bottom of your heart. And then just ask God, God, this is the best news in the world. Put on my heart somebody in my life, somebody in my sphere of influence that you want me to share this good news. And then when you're ready, come on up the center aisles and get your bread and the cup. Go back to your pew and receive it when you're ready. For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Thank you.
Thank you.
Father, we thank you for the price that was paid through your son Jesus. Father, for his body that was broken for us. And Father, as we reflect and remember today through the celebration of communion, through the songs that we sing, and through the word that is preached today, Father, we are reminded of the price that you paid for us. And Father, we are thankful and grateful for all that you've done. So God, we just come before you overflowing with worship and praise for you, our God and our King. So God, we pray that you continue to move, that you continue to speak, and it's in the name of your Son, Jesus, we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
The church is God's hope for the world. And right now, there are over 400 million children across the world living in extreme poverty. 400 million children in need of hope. This is why Compassion International exists. For over 60 years, Compassion has partnered with the church to release children from poverty in Jesus' name. At its core, Compassion is a child development organization that cares for children in poverty through child sponsorship. But this kind of sponsorship looks different with Compassion. So what does different look like? First, it looks like the church working together. We partner with churches in the U.S. to sponsor children, and with over 6,000 churches in developing nations to deliver resources and programming to those children throughout their entire childhood. This kind of sponsorship looks like relationship. Compassion connects one child with one sponsor to help the child achieve his or her God-given potential. The relational investment made through a sponsor's letter to their child is often the thing that helps that child believe that they don't have to live in poverty forever. This kind of sponsorship looks like holistic care. Children sponsored through Compassion receive physical care, educational care, social care, and most importantly, spiritual care, all from their local church. In the last year alone, over 125,000 children made first-time decisions to follow Jesus. That's one every 4 minutes. And for your church, this kind of sponsorship looks like the Great Commission. By partnering with Compassion, your entire church is equipped to serve as global missionaries. And the result is that powerful transformation takes place on both sides. Children meet Jesus and are discipled in a local church. And here in the U.S., sponsors in your church become more globally aware, more engaged, and more generous. This is what sponsorship with Compassion looks like.
Good morning. Hi, my name is Christy. For those of you who do not know, I am a Compassion Advocate, which means that I sponsor actually two children in Bolivia. Most of you do know about Compassion, but for those who don't, Compassion is an amazing organization that has been proven time and time again. They've been audited by Charity Navigators, which is not a Christian organization, but they actually go out and they make sure that these programs are on the up and up, that they are actually helping children. When I started with my Compassion Child, I guess 6 or 7 years ago, I had no idea what it really was all about. And the more I read about it, the more I just got to know my child through letters, I realized how important it is that each of these kids in these different countries have a sponsor, somebody that they can connect to, somebody they can talk to, just somebody to tell them that they love them. You know, we have so many freedoms here that we don't think about what those individual kids are going through until they tell you different things in their letters, the things that are important to them. Like, my child said, no one ever really remembers my birthday. Thank you so much for sending me a card. So through those type of relationships, you can share with them about Christ. And by sponsoring a child, you are also giving them access to Sunday schools, food, medical care. So for $38 a month, I mean, guys, when I started thinking about all the things that I do in a month, table, I go eat out, I buy little things here and there that really didn't make a big difference. But even if you can't afford $38 a month, it's okay. There's other options to help the babies. There's babies that need help as well. When I went to Bolivia to see Raquel, I couldn't believe that I had an impact on a child like that, but what she didn't realize is the impact that she had on me. That by seeing her, meeting her mother, and just hugging her, and even though we didn't speak the same language, it was as if we did for that moment. If you've ever thought about sponsoring a child, please come talk to me in the back, because it's a program that you can you have no idea until you really start looking into it, until you get that first letter from your kid with a drawing, and they draw hearts, and they tell you that they love you, and that they're praying for you. You know, somebody in the middle of nowhere praying for you. It's an amazing, amazing feeling. I also want to mention about compassion. For anybody who has children in India, we really need to be in prayer, because India is actually giving compassion, I guess you can say, trouble. They're not allowing them to send any funds in. There's over 140,000 kids in India in the compassion program that is in danger of actually not being able to have any help at all, because the government has decided that they're not going to approve them. And unfortunately, it's because of the fact that we believe in Jesus Christ. And that's the bottom line. So let's pray in prayer, because March 13th or 15th is actually the date that it's going to be decided if we have to pull out or not. So after church, if you guys are interested, want to know more about it, or if you want to sponsor a child, I have 25 packets in the back, and I'd love to help you. And Mr. Mike there in the sound booth, he knows a lot about it, as well. So just keep it in mind that we are so blessed that the little bit that we give to that child has such an impact, not just on the child, but on the family and all the people that are around them. Thank you. About 60, and then we do have some other organizations, so total somewhere about 70 children that the church sponsors right now.
Thank you, loving Community Bible Church is sponsoring 60, 70. Let's get it up to 95, all right? If God puts it on your heart, well, this is a great thing to give to. Well, this is an exciting morning because today we're going to officially induct the elders and the deacons who are serving our church in 2017. So first of all, would the following elders please come up and just line up in front of the stage here facing the congregation. Danny Collins. Okay, I had Jason Anderson written down, but it's Jason LeBlanc. Come on up here, Jason. You threw me for a minute there, okay. Chuck Como. Christian Schwest, who's a new elder, he's our rookie elder. This is where we're giving him a lot of trouble. Ray Maye. Ray Savoy. Stan Mongrew. Bubba Ogeron. Nessie Pierce. And Brian Vedrine. Now let me tell you, the church is so blessed to have these men, as well as pastors Jim Jordy and Robert Durbin, who are also elders. We're just so blessed to have this quality of men serving as elders in our church. Let me tell you, this past weekend, just spent a weekend at our annual elders planning retreat. What a delight just to get to rub shoulders and lock arms and just pray with these men for this church. It is an incredible privilege. Peter talks about what being an elder is all about in 1 Peter 5, 1-4. And there he says, "And now a word to you who are elders in the churches." Peter says, "I too am an elder and a witness to the sufferings of Christ. And I too will share his glory and his honor when he returns. As a fellow elder, this is my appeal to you. Care for the flock of God entrusted to you. Watch over it willingly, not grudgingly, not for what you will get out of it, but because you are eager to serve God. Don't lord it over the people assigned to your care, but lead them by your good example. And when the head shepherd comes, your reward will be a never-ending share in his glory and honor." And now with the following deacons come forward and stand up here, I guess, in front of the elders. Michael Grove, come on up. Matt Bjorkman, he's normally in the sound booth. He's up here now. Wayne Dobson. Sean Fontaine. Sean is our newest deacon. We're real excited. He's been in the church for a long time, and it's so exciting to have him here. Jason Hall. Chick Martin. Joe Robert. And Miles Terrebonne. Fantastic. Now, the word deacon comes from a little word, diakonos, which is deacon or diakonio, which means to serve. And man, let me tell you, these men, all of them, but these deacons, they are servants of God. And they're allowing God to use their talents and their gifts and abilities to serve Him in an awesome way here at CBC. And really, you think about it, being a servant, that is a very Christ-like quality. In fact, Jesus said in Mark 10:45, "For even I, the Son of Man, did not come here to be served, but to serve others and give my life as a ransom for many." So what an incredible blessing these men are to the ministry of Community Bible Church. So I'd now like you all to turn around and face me, okay? And I want to ask you this question. Do you promise before God, for this group of people, that you will, through the grace and through the strength of God, faithfully serve as elders and deacons in Community Bible Church? And if so, say, "We do." Let me pray for you. Father in heaven, the church just couldn't make it without believers. Lord, you've blessed us with a great, great group of men. Men who are willing to sacrifice their time, sacrifice their energy, use their gifts, use their abilities, Lord, to serve you, to further your kingdom, to advance the kingdom of God on this body. And Lord, I just pray that you'll protect each one of these men. Protect their families. Lord, protect their walks with you. Help them to stay strong and steady as they fall deeper and deeper in love with you as the years go by. So, Lord, bless them in their work. Bless them in their service. Bless the elders as they shepherd this flock and make the decisions that need to be made to further the kingdom. And Lord, just bless the deacons, Lord, in their invaluable work that frees up the elders to be able to minister the word and to pray. And thank you for all that they do around this church facility. So, Lord, we thank you for them from the bottom of our hearts. Thank you for raising them up. And help us remember to pray for these men as they serve. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So turn back around. Let's affirm these elders and deacons of 2017. And you may be seated.
Well, good morning. Again, I said that earlier when I was doing announcements, but great to be with you this morning. I am always excited when we get the opportunity to talk about Compassion International, because I started sponsoring a child for Compassion back when I was probably 19 or 20. My roommate and I at the time started sponsoring a child, and we did that all the way through when that young man graduated from the program. And then our family right now supports a little girl in Honduras who's the same age as our oldest daughter, and it gives us an opportunity to talk to our kids about having that vision for helping out others. So I'm a strong believer in what Compassion does as well. So I encourage you to check out that table at the end. In fact, it's actually been documented through research that children that are sponsored through Compassion International get more education than kids in the same areas that are not. They get better jobs when they leave the program. They are many times more likely to be leaders in their community and leaders in their church. They're more likely to be able to go on to college. And that has all been proven through research that has been done on children that are involved in Compassion. So it doesn't just change that child's life. These are new leaders that will grow up and serve in their communities and in their countries and really make a difference and an impact where they are. And the mission of Compassion International, to reach out to these kids, is the same mission as just the heart of God, that God wants to reach people. God wants to restore people to the relationship with Him that He intends them to have. And that's the whole point of our theme as we talk about reaching out in our own community. It's reaching out to people to let them know about the God that loves them, that wants a relationship with them. And as we focus this year on that idea of reaching out, and we encourage you to think about people that you can reach out to, there may be some people in your life that you think, "Oh, there's no way I'm going to even try to reach out to this person. They're too far away from God. They're too deep in their sin. They're too closed off to anything I might have to say." And that's a question I want us to think about this morning. Is it possible for someone to be beyond God's reach? Is it possible for someone to be so far away from God that we can't reach them and that He can't reach them? Well, the story we're going to look at this morning will give us some answers to that question. Pastor Bill started the series last week that we're calling God's Gallery of Grace. And it is a glimpse at the lives of people in Scripture that are transformed by their encounter with God's grace and what God does to reach into their lives. And this week we're going to be looking at the Old Testament story of a woman named Rahab. And this story is found in the Old Testament book of Joshua. If you've got your own Bible and you want to find your way to Joshua chapter 2, you can also grab one from the pew in front of you. Joshua chapter 2 is where we're going to be spending most of our time this morning. And Joshua is the sixth book in your Old Testament. So if you start at the front and go past the first five, you'll find the book of Joshua. And chapter 2 is where we're going to start. So let me pray for us, and then we'll get into this passage. Heavenly Father, I do thank you for this morning and the opportunity to gather together, the opportunity to spend time in your word. And I pray that you would just open our eyes to see your truth, open our ears to hear what you would speak into our lives. And I pray that we would get a glimpse of the grace that is available for each one of us. We ask in Jesus' name, amen. So I've got to give you some background for this story in Joshua chapter 2. And I'm going to give you probably the fastest background you've ever heard of the entire book of Exodus. So to set up the story, you've got to understand there was a point where the Israelites were all in Egypt, and Israel was serving in Egypt as slaves, and while they're there, they grew into a great nation, but they were still enslaved by Pharaoh and by the Egyptians there. And so God raises up a leader, a guy by the name of Moses, and says, Moses, you're going to lead my people out of slavery in Egypt. And so Moses does what God has told him to. He's a little reluctant here and there, but he eventually leads them. And through the plagues and all the things that go on, Pharaoh says, yes, please go. And they start to leave. And then Pharaoh changes his mind and says, wait, we're losing our workforce. And so Pharaoh then sends his army out, chasing after the Israelites that are fleeing from Egypt, going towards the Promised Land. Well, they come across a big barrier in their way called the Red Sea. And you know what happens here. Some of you have seen the movie. The Red Sea parts, the Israelites go across, and then the Red Sea comes back in and destroys the Egyptian army that has been following them. So Israel is rescued. They're free from Egypt. They're going across to the Promised Land. Well, they get to the edge of the Promised Land, and Moses, their leader, sends 12 men into the land and says, hey, go check out the land. You're going to be spies and go find out what all is going on in the land. Well, those 12 spies come back. Two of them are real excited, and they say, yes, we can do this. God's going to be with us. We can go take the land. 10 of the spies say, man, there's no way. There's big, giant people. They're mean. They're going to kill us, and there's no way we can take this land. Well, the 10 spies that don't think they can do it convince the rest of the nation, nah, there's no way we can do this. You've got to keep in mind, they just saw God drown the entire Egyptian army in the Red Sea, but they're still thinking, nah, there's no way we can do this. Well, because of their lack of faith, because of their disobedience to what God wants them, God tells them, well, you're going to be wandering around in the wilderness now for 40 years until your generation dies off and the next generation comes along. And that generation will then be able to go into the Promised Land. So that brings us to where we are at the beginning of the book of Joshua. In Joshua chapter 2, again, this is 40 years after the time of the Exodus. So we've got 40 years since the Exodus. Moses and his generation have all now died. And Joshua is the new leader that God has commissioned and put in place to lead the Israelites. So 40 years after the Exodus, they're ready to move into the Promised Land. They're ready to move into the land that God had promised to Abraham way back in the book of Genesis. But there's a problem with them moving into the Promised Land. Since they've been gone, there's other people that are living there now. They've got cities, they've got farms, they've got villages. There's all sorts of people that are there. And so they've got to clear these people out. Now, one thing that's important for us to understand, these people are called the Canaanites. And the Canaanites were really bad, wicked people. And archaeologists and historians have uncovered a lot of things about the Canaanites. They were full of all sorts of different idol worship. They did all sorts of things in the worship of their idols. They practiced human sacrifices and child sacrifices to the idols that they worshipped. There's historical evidence of some of the stuff that the Canaanites did that I can't even like talk about in church. There's stuff that they did that was so bad. These were really wicked, evil people. And so when God is sending the Israelites to drive them out of the land, the Israelites are basically kind of being God's tool of judgment upon these people as well. But God has given an opportunity to change, because he talks about them back in Genesis, but he knows that they won't. And so God is going to use the Israelites as kind of a tool of judgment against the Canaanites as well as they come into the Promised Land. But the first obstacle that they face is the city called Jericho. And Jericho is not a big city by modern day standards, but it's a significant city. It's one that has a big walled fortress around it. There are heavy walls and defenses. And it's also in a strategic place where the Israelites are not going to be able to get into the promised land until they conquer Jericho. So it's a very strategic city, but it also poses a big obstacle for them to move into the promised land. So that sets the scene. The Israelites are ready to move in on the Canaanites. And Joshua chapter 2 finds Joshua getting ready to start his campaign of moving into the promised land. So Joshua chapter 2, verse 1, tells us what Joshua does first, which is he sends in some spies, kind of like Moses did. He just picks two. I'm guessing he picked some guys that he knew would be really reliable, faithful people, but he picks two spies and sends them in. So Joshua 2, verse 1. Then Joshua, son of Nun, secretly sent two spies from Shittim. Go look over the land, he said, especially Jericho. So they went and entered the house of a prostitute named Rahab and stayed there. Okay, now just that verse. This is like the beginning of a Jason Bourne Mission Impossible movie. You've got like two spies planning for war. They're going into the city undercover. They're trying to stay disguised. They're afraid they're going to get caught. They go to the house of a prostitute. I mean, that's like the beginning of a film right there. And they're trying to figure all this out. And so while they're there, they're hiding out because they know people might be after them. Because as we'll see, the word has gotten out in Jericho that the Israelites are just on the other side of the river. They're ready to start coming in to our land. And so they're worried about it. So verse 2 of Joshua 2 says, the king of Jericho was told, look, some of the Israelites have come here tonight to spy out the land. So the king of Jericho sent this message to Rahab, bring out the men who came to you and entered your house, because they have come to spy out the whole land. And I think from the Israelites' perspective, if you need a place to hide out, it makes sense to go somewhere that visitors to the city might normally go and hang out and just blend in with the other, you know, shady characters that may be around. And it's also important to remember, as we talk about Rahab, that she is a prostitute. The Bible doesn't shy away from calling her that. That is how she is identified. And remember that she is doing this in the middle of a very wicked, corrupt culture. And so she is in a bad situation with a really bad history. But instead of turning these two guys in to the king, like he says, she offers them some unexpected protection. You know, they're probably thinking she's going to turn us in and we're going to be dead and we're not going to get to go to the land. But she offers them protection, and it's unexpected. They don't know why she is doing this at this point. But we look at verse 4, and it says, but the woman had taken the two men and hidden them. She said, yes, the men came to me, but I did not know where they had come from. At dusk, when it was time to close the city gate, they left. I don't know which way they went. Go after them. You may catch up with them. But she had taken them up to the roof and hidden them under the stalks of flax that she had laid out on the roof. So the men set out in pursuit of the spies on the road that leads to the fords of the Jordan. And as soon as the pursuers had gone out, the gate was shut. So she uses the age-old trick of, they went that way, or maybe they went that way. I don't know where they went, but you better go after them because they're going to get away. And so she, you know, fools the guys that are after them. Meanwhile, they're up on the roof hiding under these stalks of flax, which is a plant that they would use. They would dry out, and then there's a process where they would use this to make linen. So she obviously had a bunch there that she was able to hide them under it. And so it's important for us to understand in this situation as well, Rahab is really risking her life. She is risking her life in this situation. This isn't just kind of hiding somebody and then letting him go. There is a risk to her life. In fact, there is an ancient Middle Eastern law that described this kind of situation. In the ancient Middle East, this is from the law code of Hammurabi. If you ever studied history, you might have heard that. But this is actually a kind of translation of one of these laws. If scoundrels plot together in an alewife's or prostitute's or innkeeper's house, and she has not reported them to the palace, that alewife shall be put to death. So there's a statement from an ancient law that kind of shows the risk that Rahab has taken, that she really is risking her life to protect these men. And at this point, we don't know why she is doing that. Why is she risking her life for these foreign spies that are coming in to take over her city? Well, we'll find that out in the next part. Joshua 2, verses 8 through 11. There is a surprising message that the spies get from her. She is going to tell them some things that they probably never expected to hear from a Canaanite prostitute in the middle of Jericho. So there is a surprising message that explains to us why she is doing what she's doing. So Joshua 2:8 says, "Before the spies lay down for the night, she went up on the roof and said to them, 'I know that the Lord has given you this land and that a great fear of you has fallen on us, so that all who live in this country are melting in fear because of you. We have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea for you when you came out of Egypt, what you did to Sihon and Og, the two kings of the Amorites east of the Jordan, whom you completely destroyed. When we heard of it, our hearts melted in fear and everyone's courage failed because of you. For the Lord your God is God in heaven above and on the earth below.'" So she gives them a little mini sermon about what she has heard, about who God is and what God has done. So some things that she knows about God in this moment. She has heard about God's promise. She has heard about God's promise that God has given this land to the Israelites, that God is going to be with them. So she has heard about God's promise, and she has an amazing awareness that God has promised this land to the Israelites, and they're going to come in, and God is going to fulfill his promise to his people. She has also heard about God's power. She knows the story about the Egyptian army being drowned in the Red Sea. She knows about these kings on the other side of the Jordan River that the Israelites have more recently conquered. And she has heard these stories. Now, again, it's important to remember this was 40 years ago, the Red Sea thing. These stories have been going around for 40 years that the Canaanites have been saying, "Did you hear about what the God of Israel did? And now they're coming here?" You know, so they're kind of worried about what's coming up. So she has heard about God's promise. She has heard about God's power. And she believes in God's authority. She believes in God's authority, or believes in God's rule. So she believes in God's authority. It says in that one verse that he rules heaven and earth. She just has faith and trust in this God that she says rules heaven and earth below. And so she recognizes God's authority. And her first response to all of this is fear. She talks about how fear had gripped all of those in Jericho. But also with her fear takes us to the next step of faith. She realizes this is a powerful God and he can do amazing things. I would much rather believe in him and ask for mercy from him than follow after all my other gods. You know, fear can sometimes be something that motivates us towards faith. It's not always the thing that does. But for some, I've known people that their main reason for becoming a believer and a follower of Christ was fear of judgment. That certainly can be something that is a motivator for us to put our faith in Christ and what he has done for us on the cross. It is not the only motivation, but it certainly can be one. Her fear pushes her to then have faith in this God that she has heard about. But who else had the same information that Rahab had? Everybody in Jericho. Word had gotten around. This is no secret, all the stuff that God has done for the Israelites. And I think it's possible that everyone in Jericho, they could have thrown down their swords, opened up the gates, and said, "Israelites, come on in. We want to join you. We want to worship your God. And we want to become a part of your community and your people." And I think God would have welcomed them in if they had done that. But God knew they weren't going to do that. They were so steeped in their sin and in their wickedness that even though they had the opportunity, just like Rahab has the opportunity here, they didn't. They just responded with fear. So what she had heard about God, who he was, what he had done, had really gripped her heart, gotten her attention, and she was doing what she could in response to that. So hearing what she has said, the spies talk with her and they come up with a plan to rescue her. They're like, okay, she's doing some good for us. She asks for their help. And so they come up with a plan of rescue. So Joshua chapter 2, verses 12 through 21, we see their rescue plan that they start working on because they recognize her faith and her protection of them. So they want to come up with a way to get her out of there. So verse 12 says, "Now then," this is Rahab talking, "please swear to me by the Lord that you will show kindness to my family because I have shown kindness to you. Give me a sure sign that you will spare the lives of my father and mother, my brothers and sisters, and all who belong to them, and that you will save us from death." Now, one thing I think is important here is that she has concern for her family. She doesn't just say to them, "Hey, get me out of here. You know, when you guys come in and invade, just get me out." She has concern for others. She asks about her whole family and how she can protect them, how the Israelites can get them out of the situation as well. There is concern for her family. And because of her response of faith, Rahab and her family are going to be protected from destruction at the hand of the Israelites. And we have to ask ourselves the own question, the question, do we have concern for the lost? Not just people in your own family, but neighbors, friends, co-workers, whoever. Do you have concern for the lost? Because we can't ever have the mentality of, well, I believe in Jesus, and I know I'm going to heaven. I'm not really going to worry about what anybody else has to do, as long as I've got my security in place. You know, God doesn't want us to have that attitude. He wants us to have concern and compassion for those that are apart from Christ. And so the spies respond in verse 14 and say, "Our lives for your lives," the men assured her. "If you don't tell what we are doing, we will treat you kindly and faithfully when the Lord gives us the land." And I love their statement of confidence right there. There's no hesitation on their part that God's going to give them the land. It's like, yeah, we will be kind to you when God gives us this land. It's going to happen. They've got faith and confidence in God's word as well. And so she gets them out, verse 15. "So she let them down by a rope through the window, for the house she lived in was part of the city wall. She said to them, 'Go to the hills so the pursuers will not find you. Hide yourselves there 3 days until they return, and then go on your way.'" And so these men, as they leave, they're going to give her some instructions, some things she needs to do so that they know to protect her and how to protect her. "So the men said to her, 'The oath you made us swear will not be binding on us, unless when we enter the land, you have tied the scarlet cord in the window through which you let us down, and unless you have brought your father and mother, your brothers, and all your family into your house.'" So they give her a piece of scarlet rope or cord or some kind. And it's something they say, okay, take this, tie it in your window, leave it there so we can see it, and identify your house in a certain way so everybody knows, don't mess with your house. And so she's given the scarlet cord to tie in her window and make sure she gets all of her family and the people she wants to protect into her house. In verse 19, they say, "If any of them go outside of your house into the street, their blood will be on their own heads. We will not be responsible. As for those who are in the house with you, their blood will be on our head if a hand is laid on them. But if you tell what we are doing, we will be released from the oath you made us swear." "Agreed," she replied, "let it be as you say." And so she's like, okay, we got this. I'll have the scarlet cord. I'll make sure I get all my family in, and you guys will protect us. And so she puts the cord in her window. They give her this symbol to designate her home. And so then the spies move on, and they do end up getting back to Joshua, where they're able to give a really good report to Joshua. Joshua's probably been waiting for a while for these guys to show up, so now it's been a few days. And they show up, and they give a good report to Joshua. And they're excited, like, you know, they have confidence that God is going to do what he had said he's going to do. Verse 22 through 24 says, "When they left, they went into the hills and stayed there 3 days." So like she had said, go hide out for a little while. "Until the pursuers had searched along the road and returned without finding it. Then the two men started back. They went down out of the hills, forded the river, came to Joshua, son of Nun, told them everything that had happened to them." It's like you can see these guys coming in. Okay, it was crazy. We were like trying to hide out, and this prostitute protected us, and she believes in God, and she thinks we're going to, you know, she knows we're going to conquer the land, but we told her we'd protect her. And they've got this whole story that they come and tell Joshua. And then they say, "The Lord has surely given the whole land into our hands. All the people are melting in fear because of us." You know, because of Rahab's faith, that has given encouragement to all the Israelites to hear what's going on in Jericho, that they're scared and that they know that God is giving them their land. So the Israelites then get God's plan for taking over the city of Jericho. And that's a whole different sermon to do, is the process of how they take Jericho. But put simply, they're going to walk around the city for 6 days. And on the seventh day, they're going to blow their trumpets and yell, and the walls are going to fall down, and they're going to be able to go in and take the city of Jericho. But think about those 6 days that they walk around the city. Every time they walk around the city, they're going to see the cord in the window of Rahab's house. Every time they go around. I kind of wonder if the two spies are like waving at her as they go by. I don't know. But every time they go around, there's that reminder to them, okay, that's the people we've got to protect. We promised that we're going to protect them. And so there's this reminder of their promise to rescue Rahab and her family. So jump ahead to Joshua chapter 6. As the battle goes on in Joshua chapter 6, we've got the rescuing of Rahab and her family. So the rescuing that actually happens. And this is like, you know, military special ops operation, like in the middle of this battle that they're trying to go rescue Rahab and her family in the middle of what's going on here. Joshua chapter 6. It says, Joshua said to the two men who had spied out the land, go into the prostitute's house, bring her out and all who belong to her, in accordance with your oath to her. So the young men who had done the spying went in and brought out Rahab, her father and mother, her brothers and sisters, and all who belonged to her. They brought out her entire family and put them in a place outside the camp of Israel. They burned the whole city and everything in it. They put the silver and gold and articles of bronze and iron into the treasury of the Lord's house. Verse 25 is really key. But Joshua spared Rahab the prostitute with her family and all who belonged to her, because she had hid the men Joshua had sent as spies to Jericho. And she lives among the Israelites to this day. You know, at the time of the writing of the book of Joshua, she was known as somebody that's still living among us. She and her family are here, and they're with us. And we see again that her response of faith rescued her family from destruction. Her response of faith rescued her family from destruction. That there are who knows how many people that come out with her that because of her faith are saved. Her response of faith led to salvation from destruction and judgment. You know, Rahab is one of the people that is mentioned in the New Testament book of Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 11 is kind of a great history lesson of great heroes of the faith. And Rahab is one of the women mentioned in Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews 11:31, it says, by faith, the prostitute Rahab, because she welcomed the spies, was not killed with those who were disobedient, highlighting the faith that she had and what she had known about God. In the New Testament book of James, when James is looking for an example to explain how faith is demonstrated by what we do, how our faith is lived out in our actions, uses Rahab as an example. James 2:25, in the same way, was not even Rahab the prostitute considered righteous for what she did when she gave lodging to the spies and sent them off in a different direction? So Rahab twice is used as an example of faith in the New Testament. And then going back to that verse where it says she lives among the Israelites to this day, I want you to think what that would have been like for Rahab and her family. They're watching their own city get destroyed. Probably friends that they know are destroyed in this battle for Jericho. They are brought into this different culture, different community, different religion. Everything is different for them. But somehow they are welcomed in. She and her family are there among the Israelites as a reminder that God can even rescue people like Rahab. You know, when someone comes to faith in Christ, they are welcomed into a new family, to be part of a new community. 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, they are a new creation. The old has gone, the new has come. Rahab is a very real example of what it means to be a new creation. She is put into a totally new situation because of her response of faith. Now, to get to the next part of Rahab's story, I have to tell you a whole different story from a different part of the Old Testament. The Old Testament book of Ruth. And I'm going to give you a really short summary of the Old Testament book of Ruth. Ruth is about a woman who is another non-Jewish woman. She had married an Israelite man, but her husband died. And so Ruth, as a young woman, is left as a widow. And she goes back to Jerusalem with her mother-in-law, who is also a widow. And while she is back in Israel, while she's there in Israel, as a widowed non-Israelite, there's a man named Boaz that starts taking an interest in her. And this man Boaz is a respected member of the community. He's a leader. He's someone that clearly acts with a lot of integrity and shows care and compassion for this non-Israelite woman that is suddenly part of their community. Now, what would prompt someone like Boaz, a leader in the community, a respected person, what would prompt him to show interest and concern for this non-Israelite woman that has now come in to live with them? Well, Boaz, guess who his mother is? Rahab, the prostitute. And we see that in Matthew chapter 1. Matthew chapter 1 gives us part of the genealogy of Jesus. Matthew 1, it says, Salmon was the father of Boaz, whose mother was Rahab. So this man named Salmon marries Boaz. And we don't know much about Salmon other than he was a Jew and he married Rahab, welcomed her in to his household. Boaz was then the father of Obed, whose mother was Ruth. Obed, the father of Jesse. And then if you keep reading, Jesse is the father of King David. And so Rahab, this Canaanite prostitute, is included in the line of Jesus and is David's great-great-grandmother. God knows how to tell a story and put amazing pieces together of what's going on. So Matthew includes that Rahab in the genealogy of Jesus the Messiah, probably one of the least expected people you could find in the ancestry of the Messiah, would be a prostitute from the land of Canaan. So some lessons that I think we can take from the story of Rahab. There's a few different lessons that I think we can pull out of this. Number one, no one is disqualified from being transformed by grace through faith. No one is disqualified by being transformed by grace through faith. You know, this is not just an Old Testament story. There are real life Rahab stories that happen around the world. A few years ago, I had the opportunity to meet some people that work with a ministry called Nightlights Ministry. And they work in Los Angeles, some parts of Missouri, Atlanta, some parts in Southeast Asia. And the main thing they do is rescue women from human trafficking, from working as prostitutes, from working as in strip clubs. And this ministry goes into these places and gives these women a way out of what they're doing. You know, those are real life Rahabs that are being pulled out of difficult situations. God is still in the business of rescuing those women. No one is disqualified from being transformed. Also, no one is disqualified from being used by God for his plans. No one is disqualified from being used by God for his plans. Again, Rahab is probably one of the least expected people that we would expect to see God use and put into the ancestry of the Messiah. That she is part of God's plan within that. And that brings us to answer the question that I asked at the beginning of our time. No one is too far from God. No one is too far from God. We can't write off people because we think they might be too far from God. I recently heard a man tell a story. He's somebody that does college ministry, and he was on a college campus, and he was there to kind of try to share his faith with some people. And he saw this one guy studying, and he went, oh, I'll go talk to him because he'll want to stop studying to talk to me. And so he goes up to this guy and says, hey, can I talk to you about spiritual things? And usually when he does this, he gets a response of, no, I don't really want to do that. But this guy said, yeah, absolutely, I would love to talk to you about spiritual things. And so he starts a conversation with this college student, and he finds out that this college student is a Buddhist. And he's a really committed Buddhist. Like, he's such a committed Buddhist that his family is always like, why are you so Buddhist all the time? And so he's, like, really committed to his Buddhism. And so this guy that's trying to share the gospel with him thinks, ah, this is going to go nowhere. There's no way this guy is going to be interested in anything I have to say. But then this guy says something. He says, you know what? One thing that always bothers me about Buddhism, if you read the teachings of Buddha, he never tells us to worship him. There are some Buddhists that kind of worship the Buddha, but Buddha never said worship him. If I ever find out about somebody that says, I am God, worship me, I want to follow that person. Well, all of a sudden this guy clues in and goes, you know, I know somebody like that. And he starts telling him about Jesus, that Jesus was God in the flesh on earth. And he goes through the whole story of Christ being born, living, going to the cross, dying for our sins, the resurrection of Christ. And as he goes through this whole story, telling this very committed Buddhist about Jesus, he gets to the end and he says, so what do you think about all that? And the guy says, I think I'm ready to be a Christian. And so this guy goes from what the person talking to him thinks is as far away from Christ as you can, to all of a sudden, boom, he's there and ready to believe. No one is too far from God. Now, another thing that's important for us to remember is that we don't bring Jesus to people. Jesus is already at work. You know, we don't bring Jesus. It's not like, ooh, I'm the only one that can know how to tell this person about Jesus. We don't bring Jesus to someone without. When we show up, Jesus is already at work in somebody's life. We can't think we're the isolated, you know, holy person that I can come tell you. An important thing for us to do is find out, when we're talking to somebody that may not be a believer, find out what their beliefs already are. Find out how God may already be at work in their life. Maybe there's a circumstance that's making them ask some hard questions. Maybe there's someone else that has also been sharing with them, and you can follow up on what they've said. But when we show up, we can't think, you know, we're just showing up in like a vacuum and this person has never heard anything. God is already at work in people's lives around us, and we need to be aware of that. And that also helps us go into situations to talk about our faith with a little more comfort in terms of just finding out, okay, how is God already at work in this person's life? And then also we need to see that the opportunity to respond in faith to the good news of Jesus is available to anyone. The opportunity to respond in faith is available to anyone. Again, we can't write people off because God doesn't write people off. That opportunity is available to anyone. And then the message of the gospel, as Pastor Bill said before communion, the message of the gospel is salvation. It saves people from judgment and condemnation. The message of the gospel is salvation. It is essential. It is key to everything that we do. Charles Spurgeon, a great preacher from many years ago, who preached amazing sermons and, you know, probably preached through the whole Bible multiple times during his career, said this: "I would sooner bring one sinner to Jesus Christ than unpack all the mysteries of the Bible, for salvation is the thing we are to live for." You know, he got the salvation message as the key of everything we do. Yes, we want to learn about other things in Scripture and grow in our faith and everything there. He says, "I'd rather lead one sinner to Christ than be able to explain everything else in the Bible." And so then we also see in Rahab's story that responding in faith has long-lasting impact. Responding in faith has long-lasting impact. This rescued countless generations that would be her ancestors. We continue to see her story talked about in the New Testament. Her response of faith had long-lasting impact. When we respond to God in faith, we never know how much impact our lives can have from generation to generation to generation as we seek to live out our faith. And I was thinking about this week, Amy and I were talking, she was telling us a story about how her mom became a believer in Christ. That Amy's mom, there were two high school girls at her high school that shared with her about Christ. And Amy's mom became a believer at that moment, has been walking with Christ for years and years and years, and has led others to Christ, and her family is impacted by that. By two high school girls sharing with her in the hallway of their school makes a lifelong impact for others. You know, if you're here this morning and you've never put your faith and trust in Christ, the message of the gospel, the good news of salvation, is simply this: trusting in Christ alone, that his death on the cross paid the penalty for all of your sins. Believing that his death on the cross paid the penalty for all of your sins. Trusting in his death and resurrection rescues us from judgment and condemnation. John chapter 5, verse 24. "Very truly, I tell you," this is Jesus speaking, "whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be judged, but has crossed over from death to life." What will you do with what you believe? The reality of what we are talking about is that people apart from Christ face judgment. We have the opportunity to bring the message of salvation to them, to reach out to them. Whether it's as simple as inviting them to church or inviting them to a Bible study that you're a part of, or telling them your story of how God is at work in your life, telling them your story of how God has transformed your life, sharing the good news of the gospel with them, if you're comfortable doing that. But get that rescue message out there, reaching out to other people with the understanding that no one is too far. Don't write off people in your life. If you don't know how to talk, start talking to somebody, at least start praying for them. And so don't write off anyone in your life. No one is too far. Some people will respond. Some people will reject it. Some people will say, "That's interesting. I'm not ready to decide, but I'd be happy to talk to you about it more." Keep praying. And then live out your faith the best you can as well. Now, on your way out, there's a few different things that you can pick up on. There's two little tables by these doors over here, and then there's also a table in the lobby as you go out. And at that table are a couple of different things. First off, there's some invite cards. These are just cards to invite people to join us at church. There's the ones we've had for a while, and then an updated, more colorful one. You can pick up some of those to keep with you. Easy ways to invite somebody to join us here. And then there's also these little cards that on one side it just says, "This is a simple way to say God loves you." And the way to use these, if you make a meal for a neighbor, just stick one of these cards on it. If you want to pay for somebody's meal behind you at McDonald's, just hand them this card and say, "Hey, I'm doing something nice for you." These are just things to use. If you do something nice, an act of kindness to reach out to someone around you, this is a simple thing that you can give them. And on the back side of that, it's got information about our church and invites them to join us for services. But this is for something, you know, when you really do something for someone. So the church invites, God loves you cards. And then also, you get your own scarlet cord. I've got these out on the tables. And what I want you to do with this is take one of these, tie it somewhere in your car, put it at your desk, put it in your Bible, just somewhere where you will see it regularly. And I want this to be a reminder when you see this Maybe it's a reminder to pray for that person that you think is really far away from God. Or maybe it's something that's going to prompt you to say, today I'm going to make sure I tell somebody about Christ. Or maybe it will just be a reminder for you to thank God that He has rescued you and brought you to have eternal life and has rescued you from your sin as well. So I encourage you to take one of these, just put it somewhere where you're going to see it regularly as well. So I'm going to pray for us. And I would remind you, if you need lunch, there's lunch over in the FLC. If you want to support a child through Compassion, I really encourage you to go check out the table where Chrissy is going to be with that as well. And I would ask that you stand as I pray, as I close this in prayer. And Jordy is going to come forward and is going to lead us in a song where we have an opportunity to continue to praise God. And during that, if you have any prayer needs, prayer requests, things that you would like to pray with the elders about, I encourage you to come join us down front. As well. And if you want to pray with somebody about receiving Christ in your life as well, we would love to do that with you also. So any prayer needs that you have, some of the elders will be down front and we would love to pray with you this morning. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I do thank you for the truth of your word. Thank you for the amazing story of Rahab and how you rescued her from what seemed like an impossible situation. Father, I do pray that if there are any here this morning that have never put their faith and trust in you, that have never believed in you for the forgiveness of their sins, that they would do that this morning just by saying, yes, Jesus, I trust in your death on the cross, paid the penalty for my sins, and that by believing in you, I have eternal life. And Father, for each one of us, I pray that you would remind us during this week of the way that you have rescued each one of us from our sin. We would have the courage to share that message with others as well. We thank you for what you have done for us by your grace and by your love for us. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Through the cross.
God, we just come before you thanking you for your grace, thanking you for your mercy, God. And Father, I just pray, Lord, that you would put someone on our hearts this week to share about that grace and that mercy, Father. Give us an ear to listen to your Spirit this week as you lead us and you guide us, Father. It's in your name we pray. Amen.